time, I'd like to take a moment of silence. And I would also like to recognize Jamie Torres for her loss and anybody else near and dear to your heart. We now move to item 3, items presented by Mr. Administration, Dr. Tomko. First public session will be after Dr. Tomko's presentation.
No microphone.
The first presentation will be after Dr. Tomko's presentation. Thank you.
I don't think we're going to join in.
Can we shut these lights down a little more, Brian? Is that possible?
Maybe the front ones? Ladies and gentlemen, there's copies of the presentation up here. Does anyone need one? Raise your hand to get with you. No?
Yes.
I guess I should come down.
Yeah.
Have a maintenance or custodian here? Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for coming tonight. It's a very important meeting. I'm very excited to be here to present this budget to you. First thing, thank you so much. Appreciate that. Thank you. Budget is obviously probably the most important non-academic thing in a district. Okay? We as taxpayers, it's very important to us. We want to know that our money is spent towards pupil expenditures, things that are important to our community as a whole. So this is a very important meeting. I want to explain to you that a budget is a living thing. It's not something overnight that's put together, that you sit down and it's done with. It's constantly changing, okay? For all different things. Things come up out of that are surprises sometimes. There are programs that we're mandated to do in the middle of the year. So there are things that we do need to move around. What you're seeing tonight is the administration and Board of Education's presentation to you on that that budget piece of how we plan to use our expenditures this year, where our revenues are coming from. And then what happens from this point forward is we go basically line by line and we make some decisions regarding the academics, regarding personnel, and some of those things. So we'll be happy to answer your questions after the presentation. Again, we have a slide-by-slide paper up here to follow. So again, hope you enjoy what we put together for you. We worked very hard on it. So basically tonight we are going to talk about a few things that make up the Belleville budget 2015-2016. First, our district goals. What are some of our enrollment assumptions for next year that are very important to the tax levy and where the budget is for next year? Our school level goals that are obviously very important to the academics of the town and our student growth. Special education costs, programs, how we're going to keep bringing some of those students back to the least restricted environments. Okay, you've heard that term a lot, I'm sure. Technology. We've talked about technology a lot even since I've been here. We need now to get that technology into the classrooms, into the teachers' hands, into our students' hands, so that we can get them ready for 21st century learning. Security, some issues we have with security moving forward, all right, that we'll be talking about a little tonight. Our facilities are in need of some desperate upgrades. I think anyone here can see that. as you visit your neighborhood schools. Our revenue projections on what we intend to bring in this year coming forth, appropriations, where we plan on spending that money. We're going to talk about below adequacy spending, what that means exactly for the town, where we're at, where we were 3 or 4 years ago, and how we've improved there. Our administrative cost, and of course, what you're all basically here for is your tax impact. Okay, how that all boils down to your tax impact. So again, please write your questions down as we go through this. So we have a few things in district this year that we're mandated to look at. Our basic thing are contractual obligations with all of our collective bargaining agreements. One with the administrators from this past year, which is ending, and moving forward, all of the bargaining units have new contracts coming up. So that's going to greatly impact some of our costs. That's the first thing we're dealing with, and that's our goal, to meet with those negotiating teams and get that settled as quickly as possible. We want to review the district personnel needs. We need to talk about New Jersey Achieve. There are some administrative positions that we do not have here in consideration of data, in consideration of curriculum planning. We need to pass some of these CUSAC requirements that you all know we've done very poorly with in the past few years. We need to get those scores up, and that's some of the things we'll be doing with some personnel issues. We've talked about it many times. If you've been in some of the meetings that I've held already, the current curriculum program here will advance starting this July 1st. We're already working on an academy. We talked about a STEM academy, which I'm hoping the board will approve on May 18th. Our administration is working very hard on that. Industrial arts is coming back. Woodshop, cabinet making, all those things are already put in line for that. CBE, cooperative business education, where students come here half a day and then they go out into the workforce. Something else we're seeing. So those are some of the things we've been working on, as well as that technology initiative and that math K-5 brand new textbook initiative, which is hopefully the board will adopt on May 18th as well. That's a whole brand new program, K-5, and that'll be something that we'll let you know about in a few weeks. We also want to work ASAP to confirm all the spending projected for the June 30th work year. Okay, that is in consideration of that deficit, that bad word that we used to have. Okay, so we make sure we don't overspend. Be very careful with that. And we're working very hard in the business office and as administrators to take care of those, what was it, 67 or so CAF findings with some of the supports that we had in the business office. So that's what we are, some of our goals we've been working on this past year, especially since I've been here. And again, you'll see a lot of those changes as we make end of year announcements and whatnot. I wanted to bring to your attention our current enrollments. Our middle school is at 1,045 students. High school is at 1,470. There's some inequity in our school buildings. Okay? And that's basically because of size. But as you see, school 3, 4, 5, and 7 are basically in the same area of student enrollments. When you get to school 8, you're almost 100 students more there, okay, which brings more staff, et cetera. School 9 and school 10 together are almost 50 students less than the next highest school. So I'm going to be doing some investigating here, some ideas that I may have with the board, and we'll get back to you on this. But I just want the board, I want the community to know that this alignment here does cause some issues for some budget impact as well, so we'll be moving forward with that. But as we talk about these enrollments, we're going to talk about some assumptions. And this is from the State Department of Education. Okay? Basically, right from the state, all they do is take numbers and move them up. It's not rocket science. But they're projecting an increase in total population of approximately 70 students. So that means next year, we're looking at almost 5,000, 4,912. This is a very conservative projection, extremely conservative. We don't know who's moving into town. We don't know what apartment building's going up soon. We have no clue. Very conservative. This is a 1.4% growth increase. Okay? This is what we're talking about in a little bit. This 1.4% is what is the basis for what they call an enrollment adjustment. Okay? So if you remember that, an enrollment adjustment, it's important that you understand that as we move forward with the state funding figures. Okay? So this is what they based it on, the 1.4 growth increase. Extremely, extremely conservative. So let's move to our school level goals, which basically I have all the principals now working on school level goals that are going to boost student morale and achievement. Okay? We also have to look at the academic goals. Of course, we want test scores to go up. Okay? Just because, unfortunately, that's what we base a lot of assessments on. I personally don't agree with that. I'm more of a pre and post kind of administrator, where I want to see what our students are doing as they enter a grade and as they exit a grade. Okay, but unfortunately we live in a world of these assessments, we've been talking about every meeting so far, but we want to maintain our core mission and make sure that we have an educational foundation of programs in the main subject. We are a little bit behind in keeping up with this mission in science. And unfortunately that's not uncommon because everyone's talking about English language arts and math. Okay? So my goal for the board this year is to make sure we maintain that level of science. Okay? And that comes right along with that STEM Academy and different things we will see in the curriculum as we improve them throughout the summer. We have to review the personal needs at the school level, adjust them to the enrollment trends, especially in special education. Okay, by bringing more students back to these restricted environments. We need more teachers to fill those spots. It's a savings to the district, it's a savings to the taxpayer, and it's what's best for the child. Being here with your friends, socially, okay? Being involved in clubs and sports, whatever you can possibly do. So these are some of the things. We also need to look at district personnel in the curriculum areas, like I said, which we'll be looking at as well. And we want to maintain, and I even want to add to the other programs that we lost, some of the clubs. Okay, some of these things that we know students in a talent belt will really need in order to excel. They need that extended period after the school day to see that we have teachers that care, we have a district that cares, and learning continues throughout the evening. Okay, hopefully, as we work on this 21st century grant that we did great on the last time it was submitted, keeping our fingers crossed. Everyone's worked hard on that. Ms. Torres worked very hard on that. With some of our teachers here, our grant writers, we can just put some of that money, that federal money, right into those after-school programs, which would really help out. So we have special goals for special education. One of the hardest things to do as an administrator is to budget for out-of-district tuition. It's very easy to do that with the students you have already in place. But if a new family moves to town with four special ed students in need of piano lessons, let's say, it's in their IP, they move from Pennsylvania, we have to provide them with piano lessons. We get a certain amount of time to dispute that, but I had a student once that the IEP right in front of the town said he needed a blue bus. No joke, blue bus, because he had a fear of school. Okay, so some of these things do happen. They're real situations. Very difficult to provide the future of some of these tuitions, but we do the best we can. So that's our main goal when we look at special education. As I'm doing the audit, my entry plan, looking at the cost of evaluations, OT, PT, medical services, can we get other people to provide these things for cheaper or less expensive? Those are things that we're looking at. Again, Mr. Klein's doing an excellent job there with me, working together, trying to shift some of the things around. We want to make sure that instructional supplies and materials that are in IEPs get to the students, especially assistive technology. We've had students that have been waiting for computers, waiting for iPads with special programs like ProLoQ, which is an autistic program that we haven't had here. Those are things that we're starting to add now as we release this deficit and move into the future. Very important if you have a special ed student, you know what I'm talking about. One of my sons is special ed, and I know how it is to fight with the district sometimes for programs and materials that he needs to be successful. So I'm very aware of those things. And also we want to bring, like I said, LRE, the least restricted environment. We want to bring those students back to Belleville. Yes, tuition savings, but also it's the best for the student. So that's what we're looking at. Okay. We want to expand the autistic programs as much as we can. Okay? You think our teachers could do better here? I think so. Okay? And we want to keep those students here as best we can. And we want to expand that self-contained resource centers. We have some space left still for these programs. We do have some rooms now that are shared, but we're looking at that as we schedule for next year, which will be part of my 90-day entry plan presentation in a few weeks. For technology, there is a core mission here. Unfortunately, we've had some issues with it, but I think everyone is on the same page as to where we know our students should be and where we need to go. I don't think that's a secret. As I talk to the principals, as I talk to the staff, I'm going to be meeting with a focus group of students in a few days. I feel that the mission is all together. Unfortunately, the delivery was a little bit, you know, I had to take a step back. That's in the past. So as we move forward now, we're going to make sure that we support the entire district, okay? And there are, there's funding in this budget to make sure our teachers have the laptops they need to do instruction in the classrooms, to finish their lesson plans at home, and to make sure they communicate with parents on a daily basis through a portal, through PowerSchool that we have already. Okay? We also are getting laptop carts for the elementary schools, and everything's going to be the same throughout the district. Not one school's going to get more or less. Okay, we're going to be working on the labs at the high school. There's a lot of new technology coming in here starting July 1. We need to expand the department, we need to hire a director, we need to hire personnel to make sure that we don't need these companies like ProMedia anymore. Okay, we want that company out of here as quick as possible. We have our own people fixing things, making sure that the systems run. Okay, we're going to do that hopefully soon. And we want to continue to implement the technology plan. When that new director gets here, we're going to revisit that plan, obviously, bring it to the board technology committee. The board technology committee met this afternoon to discuss a new website that's user-friendly here and hopefully more parent-friendly at home. We have mobile apps coming back from PC. Hi, how are you? Mac and PC platforms, STEM labs, hopefully we'll include a 3D printer, okay? And I want an open lab at the high school. I want a high school lab where students can go on some free time and they can do some work, they can browse the web. I know there's some concern about that with different sites, but my thing is we have to trust that our kids are going to do the right thing. Let's put it out there until they do something wrong. Okay? I don't want to punish a whole population of students because people think something may happen. All right? Also, the K-12 portal. Priority access. We're bringing this out to you as parents. We're going to make sure we have professional development for you as parents. You need to come in here and get the professional development or go online and see our online professional development. We're putting it out to you. We need you to help us now. And of course, we need to make software for our security cameras. We have security cameras for all the perimeters. They weren't put in the stairwells. We're going to do that. We're going to add some to the stairwells with some of the cameras that we had in different areas that we took out. We have to do a security software program that's going to make sure that these cameras work efficiently because, again, they're not so much proactive as they're going to be reactive, unfortunately. Unless we hire 10 guys to watch all these cameras all day, it's not going to happen. So we want to make sure they're proactive as possible. Where we set up triggers, if someone opens the door, the screen flashes for the security guards, things of that nature. That takes some time, okay? Which goes along again with security. We want to expand that software, its capacity. We need to acquire additional resources. We need to have standard operating procedures for our guards, training, different things of that nature, okay? We're going to revisit the whole guard situation. Can we put in what buildings? okay? What they're wearing, different things that are also going to be implications to the implications to some budget budgetary needs. Some of our facilities here, I don't think I need to speak about it. I think you know how bad they are. It's no one's fault. It's time. It's age. So we're trying to repair as many systems as possible. We have two boilers right now that we're not going to make through the winter. That's the truth. We got to continue to purchase custodial supplies, maintain preventive maintenance programs, upgrade pest management. We have a district vehicle fleet. We have some issues with some busing. We're going to have to make some decisions with busing coming up. And we have to identify projects that are unidentified and bring that to you. In a transparent process where you as a town may have to make some decisions as we move forward, because again, not too many people have a house that's 60 years old and haven't done anything to their bathrooms yet or their roofs or things like that. So unfortunately, facilities is a big thing. So here's what everybody's been waiting for, I guess. I'll give you a second to look at that. We're looking at a $64.3 million total operating budget. Which is an increase of $1.4 million in the local tax levy. Our state government has decided to give us a zero increase on any aid, so it's a flat base, so you get nothing there. So as you see, the local tax levy through property taxes is about $37,655,000. Tuition is $172,800. That's what we're projecting. Miscellaneous revenue of refunds, 140. Extraordinary state aid that we get back for different things in special ed, etc., is $531,771. Unrestricted state aid, which is the aid that you can use wherever you really need it, $25,724,000. And the unrestricted semi-aid, which is Medicaid. Is $100,643, which gives us our total revenue of $64,335,645. Okay, again, the local tax levy increase is $1.4 million. And that's how much money we're bringing in this year. The general tax levy, we brought it back to 11-12, so you see it, okay? You're at $32.9 million in 11-12. Last year, 14-15, you were at $36.2 million. You're at $37.6 million now. Okay? It's important to know that the total increase here is 3.91%. The total increase is 3.91%. So you're saying to yourself, self, I thought it was 2%. Governor Christie said the cap is 2%. Okay? We all said yes, 2%. Right? I'm a homeowner, I know what you're talking about. However, what people don't understand is that there's also a few adjustments that the state allows, okay, in order for a district to recuperate some of those monies. And our two adjustments that we're allowed are for enrollment increases, okay, and our teacher benefits. Or our employee benefits. Okay? So we have a 2% cap that we've used plus the conservative 1.91% over that for enrollment and benefits. Okay? That's where that comes in. Okay? 2% is the allowable amount, plus the state allows Belleville for those two other enrollments, for those two other categories. Okay, pretty conservative, 1.9%. I think it's also important that you see here that the state aid is flat again. Okay, state aid is flat. It doesn't help us, doesn't help anyone. Right, it's important to know that going in. That's part of our tax money too, right? Your state taxes that you all just paid, your income tax. Part of that goes to some schools, just not Belleville. Okay? All right, so here's the other side of that balance sheet. If you remember accounting 101 back in school, right? These are the appropriations that we expect. This is our expectations moving forward, okay? And why we have that increase, okay? So that increase, the general fund appropriations, et cetera, moving forward. Probably better off I go next. The general fund should be $1.087 million. Okay? It's a 1.72% increase over from last year. This next slide is a little more important. It tells you where we're going. You need to also understand something very important when you see these slides. Okay? And we can sit here and we can talk about Belleville's past for the past 20 years and budgets that have been defeated and budgets that have been defeated and cut and 0% tax increases and bank caps. We can sit here and point the fingers all over the place. The reality is this, that $64,335,645 for 2015-16, $49 million of that, $49 million of that number is for salaries and benefits. $49 million. Okay? We are doing here instructionally a lot more with a lot less. Okay? It's important that you realize that. $49 million. Okay? And again, those years we didn't pass budgets, we didn't increase that number. Salaries keep increasing, you don't need less personnel, you need more personnel. It's no one's fault, it's just the way it happens. You know, at some point you hit a wall, at some point you hit a deficit. Okay, that's where we're at in Belleville. And now we're trying to push out of it, do the best we can, do more with less. You have to realize that. So as you look at this slide, you know, regular instruction, $19 million. You see where some of the money has increased, some of the money has decreased. There's a little bit less in charter schools. Yes, we have to pay for charter schools here. Our facilities, we have to upgrade some of those things. Technology numbers up a little bit. But again, a major percent of that money is for salaries and benefits. I think this is important to talk about too, below adequacy spending. Okay, people talk about this a lot. The state takes a 5,000 student population of a district, which we're very close to. So believe it or not, Belleville is really right on the money with this projection, according to the state. And the state says, well, this school needs a certain amount of money to make sure that all their pupils hit the spending that we feel those students need to be successful. That's adequate spending. Okay? Guess what? We're $17 million below that number. $17 million below that number. We had a difficult time raising money locally. This happens, again, not just Belleville, a lot of different places. Unfortunately, that comprehensive instructional program now takes the hit. It does. Because just like these, we're in negotiations now, and even if everyone said we're not going to take a raise, we still have to pay salaries. Everybody in this room gets a salary. It's not going away. Okay, so we're stuck with that. We need to get some revenue from state aid. No, it's flat. Okay, so it comes from either the tax levy. You know, there's really not much more we can do. But I think it's important when we put these programs in and we have plans, long-range plans down the road to budget these in. So why can't we have it now? These are the reasons. This chart, it's easier when it's in front of you. But the red is next year. But you guys went up and down here a little bit. I'm sorry. It's a little bit over the place. 2012, 2013. You are $18 million, $18.5 million under adequacy. Okay, a few years ago. So at least we're doing a little bit better now. Okay? So we keep pecking at it a little bit. Okay? There's only one town in Essex County who has a greater below average suspension. Anyone know who it is? Bloomfield, believe it or not. Okay, they're about another million older than us. As opposed to Nutley, which again, there's neighbors, I know we can't compare, they're different district factor grouping. Nutley is 500,000 maybe somewhere there, above adequacy. Okay, so that's what you're dealing with when you look at some of the neighboring towns. Okay, there's Bloomfield. I'm sorry, not least in the 50,000, which I apologize. Orange, Irvington, that's where we're at. That's it, New Jersey numbers. You don't want to think it, but that's where we're at, okay? So I think this budget is doing a lot with what we're left with. Our administrative cost, that's not administrator salaries, that's not what that is. Everything's, oh, it's administrator salaries, that's not what it is. Okay, it's an administrative cost. Anything that costs anything to run the district. We're spending this year projecting 543 less than everyone else in the region. That's pretty good. More money back into the classrooms, less money in the administrative costs. That's an important slide. And here's our last slide. Now, unfortunately, well, again, with all due respect to everyone here, this is not what you think your house is worth, okay? This is what your house is assessed at, okay? So usually your house should be assessed at less than what it's worth, okay? So if you think your house is worth $500,000, it's not assessed at $500,000. I'm not really sure. I tried to find some information from the municipality. It's been a rough week regarding where the average assessment is, but from what I gather, it's between the 300 some odd mark in there somewhere. So this is your annual impact for your assessment. If you divide this by the month, and you are at 300,000, you're looking at $15 or so, a little more a month. That's not bad. It's not a bad job. Again, more with less. Changing the view here a little bit, different sets of eyes. Okay, but I think if you study this and you look at what this board is going to create now in the next few weeks as we go line by line and we bring stuff into these classrooms, I think you're going to be very impressed with what you see. Again, patience, question before comment. Okay, there are reasons why things are going to be happening in Belleville, and it's just to make Belleville a better place. Okay? Thank you for your time. I'm sure we'll take some questions now if you have some questions. Thank you.